This tutorial shows you how to calculate the minimum required sample size for a multiple linear regression with SPSS itself. An a priori sample size calculation is done to minimize the beta error as a result of insufficient power. Or put another way, you want to minimize the chances of not being able to observe existing effects. In SPSS, go through Analyze, Power Analysis, Regression, Univariate, Linear. First, make sure that it says Estimate Sample Size, since that is what you want to calculate. Next up, you can either enter a single power value or grid power values. If you have specific guidelines regarding power, you will choose single power value. For context, power equals 1 minus the beta error probability. Beta error is the type 2 error. In short, this means falsely retaining the null hypothesis. If you want to calculate sample sizes based on multiple power values, or even a range, let's say from 0.8 to 0.95 in 0.05 steps, you can define that here as well. I will use single power value of 0.95 and therefore have a 5% type 2 error probability. In some research fields, 0.8 is used here. This means you automatically accept a type 2 error of up to 20%. If you have power lower than 0.95, this usually calls for a reasonable justification. For model predictors, you can choose between fixed and random. Fixed is the default, and you can choose random if you assume that the target variable and the predictors jointly follow a multivariate normal distribution. Now you have to specify either A, a hypothesized value, or B, an effect size. If you have information about the population multiple partial correlation value, you can enter it here. If you have comparable studies, you will most likely choose effect size though. More on that a bit later. Total number of predictors include covariates that are running alongside the predictors you have hypotheses for, aka the number of test predictors. For example, you have 2 hypotheses that test 1 predictor each and 5 total predictors. If you don't have a population multiple partial correlation value, you can also use R squared values with the corresponding number of predictors for the full model and a nested model. The latter is a simple version of the full model, containing only a subset of predictors of the full model. If you have no full or nested model information or population values like the multiple partial correlation coefficient, you will choose effect size. We already mentioned R square in the other set of options as the effect size for a multiple linear regression. The effect size required in this context is F square, however. You can easily transform R square to F square by dividing R square by 1 minus R square. The formula is in Cohen 92 a power primer on page 157. Conveniently, this also provides effect size thresholds if you have no idea what to expect. If you have research field specific thresholds, however, use those instead. Ideally, you have a preliminary study or comparative study where an R square exists. Then, of course, you should rather use that. Be aware though that R square is inflated the more predictors a model has. So, if for example you want to use 3 predictors and a study with the same dependent variable has 8 predictors, you should be cautious. Eventually, I will use an F square of 0.15, which represents a medium effect size in the behavioral and social science. That would be an R square of around 0.13. The final input parameter needed is the significance level, aka the alpha error probability, which is the probability of committing a type 1 error. In short, this is the probability of wrongly rejecting the null hypothesis. 5% is the typical convention, 1% is a bit more restrictive. A value above 5% should be avoided. Finally, hit OK to see the minimum number of observations needed to detect the presumed effect size with the predefined type 1 error probability, power and number of predictors and/or covariates. As a rule of thumb, a smaller effect size and a larger power require more observations than the other way around.